Well, good morning, everybody. Christmas is here, huh? It's December. Can you guys believe it? Which means one thing: stress. Right? Stress. So, about 50 years ago, two psychologists, Holmes and Ray, came up with the Holmes-Ray Stress Scale. They identified 43 different life events. They assigned a certain amount of points to them. For instance, you get 100 for a death of a spouse, all the way down to 11 for minor violations of the law. And then if you add all those up, those 43, you check off where you're at in your current life. If you come in under 150, you're good to go. If you come 200 to 299, you have a moderate life crisis on your hand, 50% chance of illness, such as headache, diabetes, fatigue, hypertension, chest and back pain, ulcers, anybody have an ulcer, and infectious disease. But if you're over 300 points, you're all but dead. Indicates a major life crisis, 50% chance, highly predictive that you will face a serious physical illness within the next 2 years. So let's just have some fun. Let's see how healthy you are. Imagine, let's just say we're in a Christmas season, right? So Christmas, you get 12 points just for being a Christmas. Then let's say you go on vacation at Christmas. You decide to go on a Disney cruise. Anyway, vacation's 13 more points. You're up to 25. Minor violations of laws. You're driving to catch your cruise. You get a speeding ticket. You got 11 more points. You get 36. Change in eating habits. That happens on a cruise, doesn't it? Absolutely. 15 more points. You're up to 51. Trouble with your boss. You left early to get ready for your vacation. He sent you an angry email. 23 more points. You're at 74. Trouble with the in-laws. It's even worse. How come you're not coming to see us this Christmas? 29 more points. You're up to 103. Outstanding personal achievements. You and your husband won the adult costume prize on the Disney cruise for Beauty and the Beast. That gives you 28 points. You're up to 131 points. Okay. Change in financial status. A dumb vacation cost you $6,000. You lost 38. You added 38 points. 169. You got fired because your boss is still upset with you. 47 more points, 216. And you find out you're pregnant on the cruise, 256 points. After 256 points, personal injury illness, you just got seasick, 40 more points. Actually, 53 points for seasick, 319 points. And your dumb husband heard whale, leaned over, fell off the side. Drowned right there on vacation, 100 more points, 419 points. And now you are predicted to go insane within the next 6 months. That's what stress will do to you. That's what Christmas will do to you, right? Do not go on a Disney cruise this Christmas. Well, we are now coming to our part one of our series, Peace on Earth. Today we'll look at Mary. Next week we'll look at Joseph. And then the week after we will look at the shepherds. But if you have a Bible, turn to Luke chapter 1. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. Turn on your phone to Luke, chapter 1. Or just look up at the screen and please stand. And let's read from Luke 1, verses 26 to 38. And Luke writes, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and in his kingdom there will be no end.' And Mary said to the angel, 'How will this be, since I am a virgin?' The angel answered her, 'And the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God.' And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Let's pray. So, Lord God, we come to you asking you for your leading today. Those of us who may be in doubt, stressed, fearful, today may we hear from your word and have your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So when you are afraid or when you doubt, what do you do? Well, Luke here will tell us. And I want to break this down to six sections. And first, we see the visitation. Here we see in verses 26 to 28, we see that in the sixth month, what is in the sixth month? This refers to the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Mary's relative Elizabeth, who's older than her, is also pregnant. She's in the sixth month of her pregnancy. The angel Gabriel is prominent in the book of Daniel. It's a name that Mary would have known. And Gabriel is sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, which means Luke's readers likely are not from Palestine. Luke has to specify this town, Nazareth, which you're probably not aware of, is located in the area of Galilee. Nazareth is not as big as Jerusalem. It's a small town. It's not well known. And he's sent to a virgin. Three times this word virgin is used in this passage, twice in verse 27 and once in verse 34. This was Mary's state before the conception, and it was her state all during her pregnancy. Some have supposed that virgin need not mean virgin, but just a young woman. But in context, that makes absolutely no sense. Because in verse 34, Mary says to the angel, "How is this going to be since I am what? Since I am a virgin." She doesn't say, "Since I am a young woman." That would make no sense. She is a chaste young woman who has never been with a man and won't until after Jesus is born. And she's betrothed to Joseph. You might say she's engaged, but betrothal was a little bit different than our concept of engagement. There were two stages to betrothal. The initial stage involved a formal witnessed agreement to marry and a financial exchange of a bride price. And at this point, the woman legally belongs to the groom and is referred to as his wife. Not his fiance, but his wife. The second stage, about a year later, the marriage ceremony takes place, and the husband takes the wife home. And a woman could be betrothed as early as age 12. Any 12-year-old girls in here? How would you like to be betrothed to some ugly-looking 13-year-old guy? And then go live with him for the rest of your life a year later. We don't know how old Mary was. Luke doesn't say. I'm hoping she wasn't 12. This seems weird to me. She's betrothed to a good guy, though. She's betrothed to Joseph. Much, much more about Joseph next week. We talk so much about Mary, and we are today, but next week we've got a whole sermon devoted to Joseph, because Joseph is pretty darn important as well. It says he is from the house of David. He's a descendant of David, and that is really pivotal when we talk about the Messiah. Mary means excellence. Her descent is disputed. Since she is a relative of Elizabeth, and in chapter 1, verse 5, if you look back in chapter 1, verse 5 of Luke, it says Elizabeth is a daughter of Aaron. She has Levitical roots. So Mary may have Levitical roots, but she likely probably doesn't have roots of David. She may not be a descendant of David. We're not sure, but clearly Joseph was. Verse 28, and he, the angel, came to her. He came to her. I believe that this implies the angel appeared to Mary in an unspecified indoor setting. This Greek word came literally means to enter. It's used of entering into houses, of entering into cities, and even of demons entering into a person. I don't think Mary's out somewhere. I think the angel Gabriel came inside wherever she was, maybe in her home, and appeared to her. And he says three things. First, he brings good news. He says, greetings. Isn't that good to know? Well, if you have an angel show up at your door, you don't want to hear something like, you're in trouble. Greetings. Oh, favored one. Oh, favored one. I want to talk about these three words because it's the most theological, most important theological point I'm going to make this morning. What does it mean when he says, oh, favored one? Well, in context, verse 30, the angel will also add, for you have found favor with God. To find favor in this context, the Greek verb is in the passive voice. The passive voice means the subject receives the action of the verb, which means clearly that Mary is the recipient of grace, but she's not the giver or the bestower of grace. And grace means an unmerited favor. It is a favor you cannot earn, a favor you do not deserve, a favor you cannot merit based on your behavior. And this means Mary has something totally in common with you and me, and that is she's not sinless. Her son alone is the only person ever born to a woman who was sinless, and that is Jesus Christ. He'll be conceived of the Holy Spirit, as we'll find out later, but Mary was not conceived in that way. Yes, Mary is a chaste, young, virgin woman whom God chose to give birth to the Son of God. God would not and God could not have chosen a woman who was not a virgin to give birth to Messiah. Why? Because that would have violated the prophecy of Isaiah 7:14, which says, the virgin will be with child. So there's no way, and we can also speak theologically, we can infer that if indeed sin is passed through the man, every man and woman is a sinner, and if you're born of a man who is a sinner, that you inherit the sin nature, that's a whole long discussion, then you might say that the Savior to be born could not have a human biological father. She, like you and I, needs a Savior. And her son will be that for her. Her son will be her Savior. Her son will be her Lord. Her son will be her master. And one day she will need to submit to him and not him submit to her. Kids, don't you look forward to that day when your parents will be submitting to you? Probably never going to happen. And it says, and the Lord is with you. She knows the Lord. She is a true believer in the one true God. She, as a believer in the one true God, the proof that you are a true believer in the one true God is you are waiting and looking forward to and believe a Messiah will come. Well, she's not going to need to look much further because the Messiah who she looked forward to come will come from her. She will give birth to the Messiah. She will raise the Messiah. She will clothe the Messiah. She will feed the Messiah. How amazing. The Messiah will grow up in her own home. And he's going to be perfect, unlike his siblings will be later on, if you know the story in the book of John. So this is the visitation of Gabriel to Mary. And naturally, she's apprehensive. We come to the apprehension, verse 29, but she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. There's always a but, isn't there? But she was greatly troubled. Mary's not omniscient. Mary isn't all-knowing. Mary didn't have a quiet time that morning and suddenly knew this was going to happen. She didn't walk into the kitchen that morning expecting Gabriel to show up in her house. She's not expecting this to happen at all. This is not her plan. Oh, maybe she thought one day she'd have a kid. She thought one day I'm going to marry that 14-year-old, and maybe when I'm 15, I'm going to have a kid. But she's not expecting, this is way too early for Mary. She's greatly troubled. She's confused. All Gabriel said is, hey, how you doing? You have favor with God, and God's with you. What does this mean? You know, every time an angel appears in Scripture, people are afraid. We're going to see next week that after a dream, the angel will say to Joseph, don't be afraid. They're going to say to the shepherds, don't be afraid. And here, even the angel will say to Mary, don't be afraid. But I don't think she's paralyzed by fear. I think greatly troubled just means she just can't wrap her mind around this. Hey, do you ever find that in your life? If you ever, you go through your life and life is mundane, and then all of a sudden, wow, God reveals something to you. And you're like, what does this mean for me? Because this is the truth. Your life is not going to go as you planned it to be. Mom and dad, you can raise your kids. You can tell them what you want them to believe. They can get a 4.0, and you want them to go to this school or that school. But let me tell you, your kid's life is not going to become what you planned it to be, because your life didn't turn out how you planned it to be, because God ordains all things, does he not? And so God knows the plans he has for us. Good are the plans or God's. And Mary had no idea this morning, on that morning, that day, that an angel would come to her. Imagine if you lived in London, and suddenly the doorbell rang, and you opened the door, and there is the Queen of England. Oh, favored one, greetings. And you wonder, what in the world is the Queen doing here? What did I win, you know? Why is the Queen here? It's not that Mary has won anything. She hasn't. It's what she's going to be gifted. And so that is what the angel will say to her. In verses 30 to 33, we see the affirmation. The angel said to her, don't be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God. And this is what you found favor. You are going to give birth. You will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus. Don't be afraid, Mary. This is the second time Gabriel, by the way, angels know your name. Isn't that good to know? He showed up and said, Mary, and now when he's about to say this is your mission, he says, Mary, if at all you can, use people's first names if you can remember them. It gives her a measure of calmness. You have found favor with God. It's not what you've won, it's what you've been given. Your gift is the privilege and the responsibility to give birth to and raise the Son of the Most High God. What an amazing, unbelievable thing. You will conceive. You will bear. This is not an option. God didn't say to her, hey, Mary, tell you what. I've looked all around, and you know what? I found some good young ladies, but I've picked you first. You got 24 hours to accept this mission if you want to, right? And you have this message will disintegrate in 5 seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1. And you have to decide if you are up for this mission. No. There's no decision here. This young 13, 14-year-old girl, she has no choice in this. She will conceive. And she will give birth to the Messiah. There's going to be times in your life when you have free will, and then there's going to be times when you don't have free will. And God's going to say yes to this, or God's going to say no to this. And when God closes a door, I don't care how hard you try to kick open a closed door, it isn't going to open. Because God said, you thought it was this, but it's really this. And there's nothing you can do about it. But it's always good. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. God has a plan for life, and Mary isn't running. You would think, I don't know, that she might run out of the house or run to the next room. Maybe there's no other room in her house. There is an old saying, you can run, but you can't hide. You know, when God is searching you out, better just to say, Uncle, and just let him have his way in your life. Mary remembers everything. Aren't you glad she didn't have ADD? What did the angel say to you? I don't know. I just couldn't focus, you know. I don't know. Anyway, it's another story. She remembers it. Somehow it would get communicated to Luke, who remembers it, and Luke is going to write this all down for us. Thank you, Luke, that you wrote down this for us. He says three things. The angel says, first, you're going to have a baby. Like I said earlier, you know what? She thought, I'm assuming she thought one day she'd have a baby, just not before she's married. Definitely not before she's ever done anything that could have allowed her to have a baby. You think about it. And then the only other thing I think is a little bit of a bummer here, when you think about it, is it says, you're going to bear a son. You know, when my wife got pregnant, we never really wanted to know, was it a boy or a girl? Those were the old days. Nowadays, everybody wants to know. How boring is that? Everybody wants to know, and no one can wait. Everybody's impatient. And now the big thing, of course, is when you find out you're pregnant, you want to wait 10, 12 weeks, and then you tell people you're pregnant. Everybody's all happy you're pregnant. You post on Facebook to your million friends. And then about a month later, you're like, guess what? Now we're going to have another party, right? And people show up at your party, and there's a cake or some cupcakes, and you cut it. Inside, there's either blue M&Ms or pink M&Ms. It's a gender reveal party. Poor Mary. The gender got revealed right on the spot here. You're going to have a son, and everybody knows. Oh, my goodness. Lord, that's not how I thought it was going to be. No gender reveal party later on for her. And the third thing, though, is that you're not going to have some ordinary son. He's going to be great. He's going to be called the Son of the Most High. He's going to reign on the throne of his father, David. How do you be of the house of David and then reign over the throne of your father, David? It's an amazing thing. And he's not going to reign. How long did David reign? Anybody know how long David was the king of Israel? We studied this in 1 Samuel 2 years ago. 40 years. And Jesus is not going to reign 40 years or 400 years or 4,000 years or 40,000 years or 4 million years. He is going to reign forever and ever and ever. He's no ordinary human, right? He's going to be great. He's going to be awesome. And every knee one day will bow and confess that Jesus Christ is what? Lord. Every knee. If you have not yet bowed your knee in your heart and confessed Jesus is your Lord, please do so soon and in this life, because one day you will bow, as everyone will. But not everyone will find forgiveness after this life. He is going to be awesome. He's going to be amazing. Mary, your son is not going to be Captain America. He's going to be Captain World. He's going to have that shield with the W there, you know. He is going to be Captain World, and he has that sword, and he will reign forever and ever. The only thing that I was thinking, what's so kind of Gabriel here? He doesn't tell her everything. He gives her the good news. Could have said, but you know what? Get ready, because your son will be despised and rejected of his own people. He'll be arrested. He'll be betrayed, arrested, tried, mistreated. He'll be hung on a cross. And Mary, you will be there seated at the foot of the cross, and you'll watch your son bleed and die on the cross. You don't want to know the future, do you? You just want to know what you can know today. And he spares her from that at this time. Well, we come to the hesitation. Verse 34. And Mary said to the angel, how will this be since I am a virgin? How will this be? Now, she knows the Old Testament. Way back in Genesis, the early part of Genesis, there's a story of Abraham. And God said, I'm going to give you a son. And God visits Abraham, says, I'm going to give you a son. And Sarah hears and she starts laughing, crying, ha, 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 right. I'm 90 years old. There's no way I can have a son. And God's like, well, just try me. And when she's 90 years old, she'll give birth to Isaac, a miraculous birth. Mary knows that 90-year-old women can have a son with God's help, but she doesn't think a virgin can have a son. No one does. It's impossible for her to have a son. But you know what? What's impossible with men, right, is always possible with God. For nothing is impossible with God. And she's doubting. If you were married, don't you think you'd have a doubt? So tell me, how is this going to work, Gabriel? Wouldn't you have a doubt? The other night, I was asked the question, do you ever have a doubt? Do you ever doubt in your faith? Before I answer that question, let me just give you the two S's. So take out your Sharpie and write in your hand the two S's, all right? Okay, right now. Or just pretend. There's sincere doubt, and then there's skeptical doubt. The sincere doubt is when you want to know and you believe, but a doubt creeps in and you doubt. The skeptical doubt is when you don't want to believe. You don't want to really follow. You don't want to come under authority of God. And so you will come up with every question, every smokescreen to disprove what is true because you don't want to believe. Mary has an element of sincere doubt right now. If you were to ask me, do I ever have a doubt? Well, I just know this. I've learned a long time ago that a lie is a lie is a lie, and it's always wrong, right? So, Pastor Guy, yes, I do every now and then have a doubt. I have doubts at times. What do I doubt? Well, yesterday morning at 3 in the morning, my wife got in the car and left me for Cuba. She's gone for 6 days. She has a habit of leaving me for a short period of time. In June, she went to Chicago with her family. In October, went to Branson with her family. But it's always like 5 or 6 days, and this is just 6 days long. I am confident I can live without her for 6 days. I don't know if I can live without her for 60 days. Definitely not 600 days, right? How do I know that? Because she knows I can't. So on Friday, she hands me this piece of paper. She says, to Guy about paying bills. She's basically saying, hey, if something happens to me, I know that you're in huge trouble. This whole thing, no joke, is typed out. And I'm like, well, just show me. Don't write it out. You got to show me. So I get on the computer, and I type in M&T Bank. We bank with M&T Bank, all right? And it pulls up the website. I've never once been. I haven't paid a bill in 32 years. No joke. I have the gift of delegation, okay? And so I get online, and there's this little, you know, rectangle with your checking and how much money you have in your checking account and how much money in your savings account. I'm like, wow, we got some money in there. While you're gone, I'm going to go do something with it. And she says, this is how you do it. This is how you transfer from the checking. Say you just put in the dollar amount. And so I went in, and I just typed in the dollar and pushed and I was like, wow, that's cool. That money just transferred over from checking to savings. So I'm going to mess with her. I'm just going to passing things back and forth all week. She can come back. You made 94 transactions. What did you do? Well, you showed me how to do it. Then she's like, these are the credit cards we use every month. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What is wrong with her? Why do we have so many credit cards? You get 2% off gas here and 4% off here. It's all, so you save like $19 a year, right? But it's important to her. Here's our utility bills are paid automatically. She says all these. And here's your car insurance comes quarterly, and I pay it online. I'm like, you better come back from Cuba, really. I know. Poor David, you won't be have anything if she's gone. So I don't know. I don't know how it's going to go. They left for Cuba. I haven't even heard if they got there yet. Has anybody heard? Are they there? Are they safe? Lynn? Nobody knows. What is wrong with them? Nobody cares about me. I doubt sometimes that God can use me. You ever doubt that? I sit there in that chair and almost for every sermon, even if Saturday night, and by the way, Saturday night went good. 9:15 went okay. This is going a little bit better than 9:15. And I'm like praying, Lord, this message stinks. This is not very good. You know, you're going to have to do something with this message. No joke. That's almost every week. Not every week, but. I doubt sometimes that God works all things together for good. Although Romans 8:28 says that. For we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him or are called according to his purpose. You know, for we know, and then something happens. You're like, so how is God going to take this and turn it into good? And I've doubted every once in a while that this is all really true. Please, don't gasp. Because people do sometimes. You see, I have OCD, a little bit of OCD. Rebecca, my fourth oldest daughter, Rebecca. You know Rebecca? She has a little bit of OCD. She knows it. Every night when she was back when she lived with us, she's now grown and married. Every night she'd say, I love you all. I go to bed. I love you all. I love you all. I love you. It was really not like in the Waltons. I love you all. I love you all. Because she's got to say it, because if she doesn't say it and something happens, it's like an OCD thing. I think I get it from her. So, did you lock the door? I don't know. Go back and check the door. Did you lock the door? Did you have your keys with you? You know, you get to check. You know, I was always checking this. Like, you know, what if, you know, and you can have this sometimes. You're like, I know that God is there. I know that Jesus is the only way. I know I'm saved. And once every, but what if it's not true? And then like, 5 minutes later, whatever, I'm like, I know this is true. But you have that OCD moment. Have you ever had those? People have those moments. And it doesn't mean they don't believe. It just means that when I doubt, I then believe as well. I believe while I doubt. Some of the greatest believers were the biggest doubters. If you never have a doubt, you haven't lived long enough. And God will take you through things. God will take you through. When you are in grief, you do not think the same way. And that's when it messes your mind. But that's the time that God grows you the most. Because as Job said, Job was like, everything's awesome. Everything's amazing, and God takes him through this trial. Everything's awesome. Then God takes him through this trial. Everything's awesome. And then God takes him through a year of suffering. And Job's like, God, what is wrong with you? And he's doubting God. But at the end, he says, I repent in dust. That's because now I have seen. I once heard of him, but now I've seen how great and awesome God is. You got to go through those valleys and stay down there, and then you'll come up, and your faith will then be stronger because you suffered and questioned and doubted, and God brought you back. Amen? That's how it works. It is never easy forever. So Mary has a doubt. Maybe you do as well. Mary has a doubt. But the angel is going to tell her. I remember the words of C.S. Lewis, one of the great doubters of history. He was an atheist, super brilliant, became a Christian, wrote the Chronicles of Narnia. C.S. Lewis said this, and I quote, "We are not necessarily doubting that God will do the best for us. We're wondering how painful the best will turn out to be." See, we're not necessarily doubting that God will do the best for us. We're just wondering how painful the best will be. And is God really there when it is painful? Well, God always gives answers, and so now we come to the explanation. Gabriel in verses 37 says, this is how, Mary, if you want to know how it's going to work, this is how it's going to work. Okay, he doesn't give her all of the explanation. He says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you, and therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And you know, if you need some proof, you know, your Elizabeth, your relative, and no one knows if Elizabeth is her cousin, or I'm going to just say that Elizabeth was Mary's aunt because she's older. If you want some proof, go visit Elizabeth. And Mary, right after this, will go visit Elizabeth and find out that in her old age, Elizabeth is pregnant. With who? John the Baptist. There's proof. If old Elizabeth can be pregnant, well, God is going to enable you to conceive miraculously. For nothing, verse 37, will be impossible with God. God's called Mary to an impossible task, to give birth to and raise the Son of God. And one day her husband, Joseph, will die, and she will become a single mother. Jesus might be an adult by then when Joseph dies, but Mary will miss Joseph. But nothing is impossible with God. And then 30 plus years later, she will stand there at the foot of the cross and watch her son be nailed to that tree. And she's going to have to remember these words. But your son's a warrior. And he's coming back. They may put him down now, but you can know your son will reign over the house of Jacob, and of his kingdom there will be no end, Mary. You can know, and you may not understand how it's going to work out, but he will be back. And until then, Mary, you need to know, I've got you. We all need to say, God's got me, right? But God's got me. And you guys may one day face an impossible task and go through a difficult thing, and you're just going to have to say, Lord, I doubt, and help me to believe. We close in verse 38 with the decision. And Mary said, Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. As the worship team comes up, she says, Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. We all have to make that decision, whatever we're facing in life, and say, Lord, whatever you're calling me to do, whatever faith stretch you have for me, whatever sacrifice you're having me make, whatever mission you're calling me to do that I'm not sure I can do, I'm the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. Have you surrendered your heart to him? Have you surrendered your career to him? Have you surrendered your health to him? Have you surrendered your children to him? Have you surrendered everything to him? May it be to me, as you have said. Let's stand. Let's pray. Just close your eyes. And whatever it is that you think is impossible, maybe you're not sure you can be forgiven. Well, yes, you can. Jesus died for all your sins, paid for them on the cross. If you call on his name, repent of your sin, you get the gift of eternal life. Maybe you think God can't use you. Maybe you think you're not good at anything. Well, God takes weak people and he makes them strong. Maybe you think you'll never have the career you thought you could have or the companionship you want to have or whatever it is. Well, God's got you. God's got you. And he's there with you right now. And he is going to be your everything. You just have to let him. So go ahead. If you feel that, put a hand up to the air. Raise your hand up. Say, Lord, in your own heart, Lord, I trust you. I believe in you. I want to follow you. I want to give my whole heart to you. I want to believe what I can't see. I want to believe what I don't understand. I know that you're true. I know that you are the way, the truth, and the life. And this morning, I come surrendering again to you, saying, Lord, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me. It's according to your word. Thank you that you're here today. And I thank you, nothing's impossible with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, the ushers are coming up front to take our morning offering.